Last week, we saw the Father's work in Advent as emphasized in the acting out of his plan of redemption that he made out before the foundations of the world in the beautiful, harmonious relationship of love between Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And that, in fact, this plan of redemption is actually a gift to us. It's a blessing for us, this blessing of redemption that's paid by the blood of his own Son, Jesus Christ. But the grand mysterious question we must ask ourselves in this particular moment as we understand and receive the cosmos shaper whose fingers and toes are counted by a human mother is this: how in the world does God the Son have blood to begin with? How does he have veins in his body if he is the most magnificent, omnipotent being in all of reality? It is in this Advent season where we are called to contemplate this mystery, where we are called and to be reminded to recall essential beliefs about the Christian faith that are unique, more unique than any other religion in this world. One predominant understanding that is unique, and I've shared this before, is that we believe the whole essential foundation upon which we have salvation is not just the exaltation of our God, but it's humiliation of our God. And that he would condescend to our level, that he would put on flesh and blood and walk among us, get dirt under his fingernails, touch those who are never meant to be touched, heal those that were never meant to be healed, raise from the dead those who were in the clutches of death and Sheol. We're speaking of a mystery that is essential to our belief. It is our belief in the incarnation of the Son of God that presents to us the work of the Son in Advent, which is our theme for this morning. For of course, Advent means coming. And who is coming? Emmanuel, God with us, the Son of God in the flesh. And he chooses intentionally, purposefully, fulfilling the plan before the foundation of the world, before humanity was created, the plan that God would step into humanity was already set in stone. And here he shows up in his incarnation. That car in the Latin, caro, or as many of us who live in Santa Maria, predominantly a Hispanic culture, we know of carne asada. Carne meaning flesh. That if we were to take the incarnation and to literally translate it from the Latin segments of incarnation, it would mean the enfleshment of God. So let's begin with an origin text to discover the enfleshment of God this morning. Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 through 25. I'm in the Christian Standard Bible this morning. Follow along with me if you don't have that. The birth of Jesus Christ came about this way. After his mother Mary had been engaged to Joseph, it was discovered before they came together that she was pregnant, but with the caveat, from the Holy Spirit. So her husband Joseph, being a righteous man and not wanting to disgrace her publicly, decided to divorce her secretly. But after he had considered these things, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, "Joseph, son of David, don't be afraid to take Mary as your wife, because what has been conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to name him Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." Now all this took place to fulfill what was spoken by the Lord through the prophet. "See, the virgin will become pregnant and give birth to a son, and they will name him Emmanuel," which is translated, "God is with us." And when Joseph woke up, he did as the Lord's angel had commanded him. He married her, but did not have sexual relations with her until she gave birth to a son, and he named him Jesus. I am 40 years old. I grew up in the privilege of growing up in a Christian home. I can honestly say I've probably heard this story over 40 times at least, every single year. That's the minimum of hearing this nativity story. Much more for maybe some of you. And it becomes easy for us to glaze over the story because so often than not, Christmas is an avalanche of themes. It's an avalanche of experience. It's an avalanche, an inundation of lights and poinsettias and trees and presents and food. Oh man, the food. The feasting. And the story, the origin, the foundation of which all of these come together can somewhat be glazed over like a Christmas ham. And we lose out on what is actually happening. And I love to ask this particular question when looking at the nativity story of Matthew chapter 1, is this, what's happening behind the curtain? What's happening behind the veil of our reality to the truest reality? The kingdom of God has come. That's what the prophet says. Emmanuel has come. Messiah, the Redeemer, is here. And that, my friends, to many is a mystery. Even so, to the point that the majority of the religious leaders at that time, the ones that knew the Old Testament, the Torah, inside and out, many by memory, had no clue who this Yeshua, Yamashiach, actually was and is. I love to embrace this mystery. Why? Because I believe the apostles love to embrace this mystery. The apostle John was a man who delighted in the mystery of God, concerning particularly his incarnation. His choosing to begin his gospel as the same as Genesis, right? In the beginning, is appropriate to define for us just what God was accomplishing in his coming to earth. Now, when I say mystery, I don't mean some sort of Agatha Christie, Sherlock Holmes, BBC murder mystery. I'm talking about what the scriptures define as mystery is something that you would not know unless it was revealed to you and shown to you, taught to you. It's as if God himself steps down from his throne room and says, I want to give you a secret. I want to tell you something. And I'm calling you to share with everyone that you know what this beautiful secret is. It is my son who is coming in the flesh. He chooses, John the apostle, chooses to use the same wording as Genesis to define for us just who and how mighty, how divine this Jesus who's put on flesh is and is coming to earth. Even later on in John the Apostle's epistles in 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, we see that they were largely an apologetic work against the heretical viewpoint that Jesus really wasn't truly human. It was this new breeding that was called Gnosticism, which denied the incarnation. And John wonderfully articulates the purpose of writing anything. Anything that he is writing is because the Son of God has come, not just transcendentally. He's not just floating and hovering over us without a body. He's not a ghost that has not put on flesh. No, the whole point of writing anything, the Apostle John says, concerning the gospel, concerning salvation, the predominant factor in all of this is that God has put on the flesh and dwelt among us. Let me prove it to you. 1 John chapter 1. He uses his first words of this epistle. What was from the beginning. Once again, we go back to the Gospel of John. In the beginning. Once again, we go all the way back to Genesis. In the beginning. What was from the beginning. What we have heard and what we have seen. The apostles are saying. What we have seen with our own eyes. And not just that. What we have observed. How we have touched him with our hands concerning the word of life. That life was revealed and we have seen it And we testify and declare to you the eternal life that was with the Father and was revealed to us. What we have seen and heard, we also declare to you, so that you may also have fellowship with us. And indeed, our fellowship is with the Father and with His Son. His name is Jesus Christ. We are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. You know what that says to me about the revealing mystery of God the Father in sending His Son to put on flesh? That if you don't know Jesus, there is no way for you to know what complete joy looks like. If you don't know Christ this morning, you have never experienced what complete happiness truly is. Everyone is born in the image of God. Every human being has been born in the image of God Himself to represent Him to the rest of all creation, but there is a piece of you that's missing. And that can only be satisfied if your joy may be complete in believing the mystery that's been revealed to you this morning, that you might know eternal life. And in knowing eternal life, oh, that happiness would be complete. Without the incarnation, my friends, we do not have true access to salvation. If you don't believe that Jesus came to this earth and put on flesh, I'm sorry, you cannot be a Christian. You cannot be a Christian. In the second century, there was a heretical belief, a heresy, that began spreading around Christendom in the second century. And it was called Docetism. Anybody, raise your hand, you ever heard of Docetism before? Guess what? It's back around in modern talks. The beautiful thing about modern heresies is that they're never modern. They've just been rehashed, put in some crock pot, divvied up by some crock pot or crack pot. And all of a sudden they have some new revelatory thing to say that Jesus was never truly human or never truly God. Docetism, this heresy, was coined from the Greek word dokesis, which means to seem like. It taught Jesus only appeared to have a body and was not truly incarnate. And then docetists viewed matter, all things in creation, as inherently evil. Only the spiritual was holy, and therefore rejected the idea that God could actually appear in body form. And by denying Jesus truly had a body, they also denied that He suffered on the cross and rose from the dead. You see how important the incarnation is? And this belief began with the early Gnostics, and it was condemned as heresy at the Council of Chalcedon in 451 AD. It's important for us to know the Word of God, my friends, to be able to give a defense for what we believe. And guess what? It's not my job. It's all of your guys' job. Because John tells us the Word did become flesh, has dwelt among us. We observed His glory, the glory as the one and only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. You know what this tells us then? Because we're not Docetists. We're not Arians. We believe in the incarnation of Jesus. This tells me something very real. The incarnation is able to be defined in the Christian faith. To those that don't know the Christian faith, it's not just a philosophy. It's not just some sort of spiritual, transcendent experience that we all just kind of say, you know what? This story tells us that Jesus came in bodily form. He put on flesh. He dwelt among us. Whether that's true or not, that's, you know, you can believe it, you cannot believe it. You just follow what the Bible says as a moral tale, baloney. It is not a spiritual transcendent experience. It is not a philosophy. It is a historical fact. An event in the flesh whereupon we find the means of our salvation. Oh, if Christ has not come and dwelt among us, has not condescended to our level, then we, as Paul declares, are to be most pitied. We might as well close the doors to this church and go join Rotary. I want to tell you that the incarnation of Jesus coming fully human and fully God is a necessity of belief to be a believer. You cannot claim to be a believer in Jesus Christ if you cannot also affirm that he is both God and man at the same time, and also currently, right here and now, both God and man. The first 2 centuries of church history was combating and defending against the heretical beliefs against the deity and humanity of Christ. Like we said previously, much of John's epistles was a defense against heresy that was invading the church, mainly concerning Jesus' deity and humanity. Some would say he was only God and did not put on flesh, and some say he was a wonderful prophet and rabbi, but he wasn't God. Both are destined for hell. This is why John, in his epistle, he says this. He gives us a litmus test. My dad used to clean pools, and he would always test the pH of the water by checking with a couple of these paper tabs. And as a kid, I would look at these tabs and want to play with them, stick them in water. I'm sure he lost a lot of them because I was getting into them. Why do I keep running out of these things? And discovering the acidity, the pH of the water for swimming in pools. Friends, this is the litmus test by which we test every spirit that we encounter. And I guarantee you encounter spirits on multiple levels every single day of your life, whether you believe that or not. 1 John chapter 4. Dear friends, put yourself in receiving a letter. Many of us are getting Christmas cards. Receive this Christmas card from the Apostle John. Dear friends, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see that they are from God. Because many false spirits have gone out into the world, and this is how you know the Spirit of God. Listen, every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in what? The flesh is from God. But every spirit that does not confess Jesus is not from God. This is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you have heard is coming. Even now it is already in the world. You, my friends, brothers and sisters, you are from God, little children, and you have conquered them, those spirits of Antichrist, because the one who is in you is greater than the one who is in the world. They are from the world. Amen. Yeah, you can give John a round of applause. It's not me who's saying it. Therefore, what they say is from the world. And the world, what? They listen to them. We, you and me, are from whom? God. Anyone who knows God listens to us. Anyone who is not from God does not listen to us. This is how we know the spirit of truth and the spirit of deception. Friends, what you believe about Jesus has eternal ramifications in your life. And the way that you know who Jesus is you know the word that he speaks. What we believe about Jesus has eternal magnitude. But not only is the belief in the incarnation just a theological practice, we're not just checking off the box of our doctrine in order to make sure, do I fulfill the list of what I believe in order to be a Christian? These things are extremely important, just like John related in his epistle. But we must also know the incarnation is highly theological, but it would mean nothing if it wasn't highly relational to you and to me. Because I tend to believe everybody in this room is human. And because you're a human, you have a direct connection with the God who has put on flesh and became human for you. The writer of Hebrews, some say was Paul, others say was Apollos, relates the incarnation of the Son of God, a means by which you and I have relation with him now. How do we have relationship with the cosmos shaper of the universe? How do we, fallible stinky, knuckleheaded people have relationship with the omnipotent being of all things. The writer of Hebrews says this, "For in bringing many sons and daughters to glory," if you're a son, say amen. If you're a daughter, say amen. "For in bringing many sons and daughters to glory," it was, I love this translation part, "it was entirely appropriate that God, for whom and through whom all things exist, should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect through sufferings. For the one who sanctifies and those who are sanctified all have one Father." What does that mean? Jesus has a Father, Father God. You have a Father, Father God, because of Jesus. "For the one who sanctifies and those who are sanctified all have one Father." That is why Jesus is not ashamed to call you brother and sister, saying, "I will proclaim your name to my brothers and sisters. I will sing hymns to you in the congregation. Again, I will trust in him. And again, here I am with the children God gave me." Now, since the children, listen, here's the relationship emphasis. "Now, since the children have flesh and blood in common, Jesus also shared in these, so that through his death, he might destroy the one holding the power of death, that is the devil, and free those who were held in slavery all their lives by the fear of death." The potential of a human having salvation can only occur if a human wins salvation. And that is through Jesus, the superior Adam, the superior human. The Logos of John chapter 1, that's who he is, Jesus Christ. The Word became flesh. It reveals to us not only are we in desperate need for relationship, but it's his willingness to condescend down to humanity, who he has created, who he loves, who he gave his only son to die for. I'm losing my voice. I want to share with you a quote from my professor at Western Seminary, Dr. Gary Brashears. He observes this in his book called Doctrine. He says, "The Logos," speaking of Jesus, "the Logos is one of the strongest arguments for the deity of Jesus as the personal, eternally existing creator of the universe, distinct from, yet equal with God the Father, who became incarnate," came in the flesh, "to demonstrate his glory in grace and truth, to reveal life and light to men." For the second person of the Trinity, the Son of God, for the second person of the Trinity, the events of Christmas, I love this, were deeply experiential. Jesus experienced Christmas as you experience Christmas. The events of Christmas were deeply experiential, with a real and profound implication on his life from that point onward. He left the comforts and adoration of heaven to become a human with all of your and my frailties and limitations. He was born into a country. He was born into a culture, a people, the Jewish people. There's word going around that Jesus was a Palestinian. He was not. He was a Jew. And guess what? He still is a Jew. He was born into a family, a subculture. He wore the clothes that the people wore. He participated in their traditions. He ate. He slept. He became one of us. Not God masquerading as a person, but Jesus dwelling bodily. Therefore, by incarnation, we mean that the eternal second person of the Trinity entered into history as the man Jesus Christ. In his incarnation, the Creator entered his creation to reveal God to us, identify with us, and live and die for us as our humble servant. And friends, this is why your joy and my joy is being made complete. The King of the universe is here. If he is Emmanuel, that means he is God with us. And because he ascended does not mean that God is no longer with us. He is here with us right now. That either terrifies us or it completes our joy. I want us to understand something about the mystery of the incarnation too. That's been revealed to us by God the Father through the Word of God by the empowerment of the Spirit. And it's this. When you read the Old Testament and you read the prophets prophesying of the coming Messiah, would you just understand as a human to another human that lived centuries and centuries ago who was given the Word of God to speak, as they're speaking, they're saying, I just feel the weight of this. As Jeremiah and Zephaniah, Malachi, Isaiah, Ezekiel, as they said, there's a Messiah coming. He's coming to bring salvation to his people Israel. You who have committed spiritual affairs of wickedness with demonic beings over and over and over again, he's coming to bring salvation to you who don't deserve it. He's coming to save you. Can you hear the words of the prophets crying out? Because I feel this as the prophets are saying Messiah is coming. They are just longing. I want to be the one that sees him to come. I want to see him in that manger. I want to see God in the flesh. Those shepherds, those stinky shepherds that had no theological background got to witness the very cosmos shaper in the flesh that the prophets of old longed to see. Zephaniah cried out, would you sing for joy, daughter of Zion? Shout loudly, Israel. Be glad and celebrate with all of your heart, daughter Jerusalem. Yahweh has removed your punishment. He has turned back your enemy. The King of Israel, the Lord, is among you. You need no longer fear harm. On that day, it will be said to Jerusalem, do not fear Zion. Do not let your hands grow weak. The Lord your God, once again, is among you. He is a warrior who saves. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will be quiet in his love. He will delight over you with his singing. The King of Israel, the Lord, is among us. As the shepherds and the wise men were be able to say, he's among us, he's here, he's right now. I imagine they would look at the prophet Zephaniah and say, the warrior has come, he saves. He's a baby in a manger. This is the warrior that will save us? Yes. Yes, he is. The royal son of David has come. R.G. Lee, who is a writer, he says this about the incarnation. Christ, who in eternity rested motherless upon the Father's bosom, and in time rested fatherless upon a woman's bosom, clasping the Ancient of Days who had become the Infant of Days. What deep descent have you done? From the heights of glory to the depths of shame. From the wonders of heaven to the wickedness of earth. From exaltation to humiliation. From the throne to the tree. From dignity to debasement. From worship to wrath. From the halls of heaven to the nails of earth. From the coronation to the curse. From the glory place to the gory place. In Bethlehem, humility and glory in their extremes were joined together. Born in a stable, cradled in a cattle trough, wrapped in swaddling clothes of poverty. No room for him, he who has made all rooms available. No place for him who has made and who has known every place. Oh, the deep humiliation of our Creator, born of the creature woman, but in his descent is the dawn of mercy, because we cannot ascend to him, so therefore he has descended to us. The incarnation is theological, it's highly relational, But I love to give you this news, my friends. The incarnation of Jesus is also eschatological. It's a future coming. One of the things that I believe, that I think we as the evangelical church of the nation of the USA extremely lack, is a focus on his incarnation and the lack of beauty and doctrine, but not only in his incarnation, particularly in his ascension. That's why I love Ascension Sunday. It's one of my favorite Sundays to get to teach you once again how important the ascension of Jesus is. When Jesus died and rose again, he didn't live his life and die a second time. He didn't go to Japan, which is some people believe, sails to Japan and starts a family. He didn't go hang out with the Buddha. He didn't hang out with Muhammad. No, it says he ascended into heaven. But let's just look at this in closing. This is our final scripture for this morning. Acts chapter 1, verses 9 through 11. This gives me joy for the second advent. After he had said this, he was taken up as they were watching, and a cloud took him out of their sight. Did you catch that? After he had said this, he was taken up as they were watching, and a cloud took him out of their sight. And while he was going, it's as if they're like looking up and he's like, while he was going, they were gazing into heaven. Don't tell me you wouldn't do that either. You would be doing the exact same thing. Gazing up into heaven. And suddenly, two men in white clothes stood by them. And they said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up into heaven? This same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come." One of the two greatest words in all Scripture. "Will come in the same way that you have seen him going into heaven." So the picture is clear, is it not? That when he ascends into heaven, it's not as if his human body as this bag of flesh just slumps to the ground. This duffel bag of meat. But in fact, his entire humanity, with the scars on his hands and the wound in his side, the pockmarks of the crown of thorns, that in his resurrection are still there to proclaim his conquering over sin and death. He ascends bodily into the throne room. That means, my friends, when he put on flesh, that was a permanent decision, an eternal decision. There's not going to be anywhere in Scripture where he says at some point in time he's going to take off his humanity. He permanently resides right here and right now. Humanity, physical, tangible, touching, is there in glory in the throne room of the living God, sitting at the right hand of the Father, mediating for you. That means humanity sits on the throne of God right now. And that gives you access to the throne of God right now. Only because nothing that you could do. You cannot ascend. He only can ascend. But he's coming back to gather you. And that does not mean thousands upon thousands of duffel bags of meat laid on the ground in his soon coming. But we rise with him fully and whole, complete, body, soul, and spirit. As the writer of Genesis says in Hebrew, the nefesh hayah, the complete man, will rise with the perfect and complete man. That I so long, as the days get darker and darker, I, like Zephaniah has said, the warrior who saves, he's coming. He's coming, and let us be ready. The real, tangible habitation, the dwelling place of heaven, has been made for you by the perfect God-man. And because he's human, he knows exactly what you need. He knows exactly what you long for. He knows how what desperation looks like. He knows our longing. And I guarantee you, he's saying in just a little while, just a little while, just be faithful, be patient. Let's pray together.